start. I know, first of all, Dan wanted to make an announcement. He's okay? Okay, great.
It's just the clothing sale.
Okay, so the clothing sale, LSS, make sure you pay attention to that. So we're going to continue our discussion about treaties today. It's our last discussion on this topic. And then next class, we're going to be dealing with crown obligations. So we'll be talking about the Haida and Tapu cases. And then the following class will be Inuit rights. And so please prepare in that regard. Today we're going to be talking about the Grassy Narrows case, which is the latest word from the Supreme Court of Canada dealing with treaty rights. And here you see a picture of the Grassy Narrows territory. And the Grassy Narrows people are concerned about the clear-cutting that is happening throughout their region. And they've been concerned for quite some years. In fact, in the 1970s, in the Grassy Narrow territories around Dryden, Ontario, there was significant mercury poisoning amongst the First Nations living in that area. That mercury poisoning is caused by the effluent and discharges that come from the pulp and paper mills that are in the area, that come from not having a healthy environment to be able to take up some of the toxins that are resulting as from the logging that's taking place in their area. And so since the 1960s and 70s, the Grassy Narrows people have been very resolute in trying to resist the encroachments on their territory. And you'll see from time to time in the papers, in the media, that they continue to blockade and use direct action to try to prevent people from accessing the territory in the industrial logging phenomena. Now, they are not opposed to logging. They do want to see healthy use of their land, which includes their traditional activities of hunting and fishing and gathering. Of course, they also are involved in seasonal labor with construction and working in the towns and whatnot. They also want to be a part of the logging industry, but they do want to see that logging occur on a sustainable basis. And so their challenge is to try to find a way to ensure that those that come into their territory respect the sense that they have of their own laws, their own relationships to that land. This is a map of where Grassy Narrows is. You can see it's between Thunder Bay and Winnipeg. It's north of what's called the Lake of the Woods area. This, in historical terms, when Canada was formed, used to be called the in-between lands, because it was in between, obviously, the major centers as Ontario was expanding out across the north of Lake Huron and Lake Superior, and in between that and the Red River settlement, which is where the Métis people were born and flourished as a community, and where Canada had its designs as it was trying to expand west. You see the Asubpeeschoseewagong First Nation, the Grassy Narrows First Nation, is part of this area just north of Kenora, Ontario. These are Anishinaabe people. I've told you before that the Anishinaabe people live in Ontario and Quebec, across through northern Ontario, up into Manitoba, into Saskatchewan, and then down in Michigan, Wisconsin, Minnesota, out to Dakota, etc. So they're part of a larger political, linguistic, social group. The Grassy Narrows First Nation have a history about how they relate to this territory that takes guidance from their old laws and their old stories. I want to talk about a couple of them to set the stage for analysis of the treaty, because it's important, as we've been doing all along, to recognize that when Indigenous peoples were signing treaties, they came with their own standards for judgment. They came with their own laws, their own values. They came with their own criteria by which to measure whether or not an agreement had been made, what the scope of that agreement was, what the consequences were for the breach of an agreement. And Anishinaabe people had stories about treaties. and how those treaties were enacted. One of those stories has to do with a time when the Anishinaabe noticed as they were walking through their territory that there were no more deer and caribou and moose that were living amongst them. And they walked from corner to corner to corner to corner of their territory searching for these animals. One day they came across a group of crows on Dekwa. And they asked the crows what had happened to the deer, caribou, moose. And the crows said, they're in our territory. And so the Anishinaabe people went into the crow territory, that is the birds. They went to the bird territory, the Andegwak, and they started a war with the crows. And this war was long and bitter, and the battle was quite fierce as the Anishinaabe and the crows were attacking one another in that crow land. As they were fighting, the Anishinaabe noticed that the deer and the caribou and the moose were standing along the sidelines, just watching. The Anishinaabe were kind of perplexed by that as to why these animals weren't coming to their aid against these birds. And eventually there was a truce called in the battle. And out of that battle, then the Anishinaabe went to the deer, the moose, the caribou, and they said, why are you so unconcerned about our attempts to rescue you here? We are risking our very lives. We are giving all that we have to be able to take you out of captivity. And the deer chief said to the head of the Anishinaabe, you are mistaken if you think that we are here against our will. Because you did not treat us well when we lived amongst you. You wasted our flesh. You despoiled our haunts, the places that we live. You didn't leave anything for us as you took us from these territories. And we are here with the crow in accordance with our own will. Because they have treated us better than you ever did when we lived in your territory. The Anishinaabe were surprised at hearing this, and they said, what can we do to make amends? And the deer chief said, we can enter into a treaty. And in that treaty, we can devise how you will act when we come to live amongst you so that you will respect us by not wasting our flesh, that you will respect us by ensuring that we have a place to be able to live, that our haunts will not be despoiled, and that when you take us, again, you will leave something in return, like tobacco or some other gift in recognition of the life that you take with us, from us. And the Anishinaabe, chastened by, sobered by this message, hearing this offer of treaty, entered into an agreement with the deer and the moose and the caribou to be able to follow that path of life. There are many stories that the Anishinaabe people have about how they entered into treaties with different nations, the deer nation, the caribou nation, the moose nation, the crow nation, after this fight that they had with them. And so when Anishinaabe people would encounter others that wanted to enter into an agreement with them, they would have a backdrop of understanding about what it was that was expected of them. Right? A morally and politically defensible conception of Aboriginal rights will incorporate both the Aboriginal legal perspectives and the common law legal perspectives. So when Anishinaabe people were entering into treaties, you know, it was done in the shadow of the law. Not necessarily the shadow of the common law, but their negotiations were formed in the shadow of their own understandings about what is a proper obligation, how you keep obligations, how you ensure that if those break down, they can be properly renewed. So there's a lot in those cases, in those stories, that are precedential, that are, again, standards for judgment, criteria, authoritative. They are the measures by which people would look in trying to gauge what their relations would be with others. Of course, they didn't just have experience with the crow and deer and caribou nations. They also had experience with other people. Anishinaabe people entered into treaties with the Lakota people, which are to the south of here, the Dakota and Nakota people. We've already talked about treaties that they entered into with the Haudenosaunee people, with that Turowampum, or say that dish with one spoon belt. For other stories about the first, what's called Jaganash people, the English people that came into this territory. And this story that I'm about to tell you is actually associated with a song. And I'm going to tell you the story, and I'm also going to sing the song. And the importance of that, again, as in the Delgamuukw case, is to be able to understand that law is not just something that you write or you illustrate with words on a page, but it's something in this tradition that's performative. I'm not a great performer, I'm not a great singer, but I do this to be able to lay down another understanding in your mind about what would happen when treaties were signed. Because there would be pipes that were smoked, there would be prayers that would be offered, there would be songs that would be sung, there would be dances. Dancing as a part of law is one way to be able to embody what the stories are, what the principles are, what it is that you're hoping to accomplish as you interact with others. And I know on this territory and in this part of the world, on the northwest coast, dancing incredibly important for law, with the masks and the button blankets and the stories that are part of that. But this story comes from a person named Kwekwe. It's actually a 300-year-old story. And it comes to me through a person that has been last named as Kwekwe Benesi, which is kind of like shaking, calling out bird. Then that story was passed on to Tobasanaquit, which is a low-hanging cloud. Tobasanaquit is Wab Kanu's father. If you've ever heard about Wab Kanu, who's a broadcaster out of Winnipeg. Tobasanaquit told the story to Pabamabenes, which means the thunderbird that goes around. And then Pabamabenes passed it along to me. And this story is a story about a man who lived about 300 years ago. And he lived in this area that we're talking about, to the west of Thunder Bay. And when he first encountered this Anishinaabe man, first encountered Jaganashi people, just trying to get out from beyond the head of the lake, he found these people in great desperate need. They were in dire straits. They couldn't eat. They couldn't find their way through the territory. They were lost. They were going to die, perish, if they didn't receive aid. And so this Anishinaabe man extended aid to them in accordance with the traditions of hospitality in the territory. And the people, in receiving that aid, showed their appreciation, and they gave him some of the goods that were a part of what they had brought with them into that territory. Some of the kettles, some of the cloth, some of the tobacco, some of the things that they were using as they were venturing out from beyond the lake. And this man, Anishinaabe man, took these goods and he brought them back to his community. And there was an appreciation for what was received. They saw the value in the cloth, in the tobacco, in the utensils that were a part of that exchange. And so the next year, this man took some pelts that he had gotten from his hunting over the previous season, and he thought he would go check on these people and see how they were doing. They were still struggling. It was still a challenge for them to be able to make their way in that area, and they were very grateful to receive the goods that were brought, one for their own warmth and sustenance, along with the food that he brought along. And then secondly, because they could then use those furs, and they could take them and they could trade them through that network that went down across the Great Lakes, out through the St. Lawrence Seaway, off into London, and would help bring them another kind of sustenance. In return, this man, the Anishinaabe man, again received many goods from the people that were settled from England in this area, the traders. More utensils, more cloth, more tobacco, other types of objects. And the story actually talks about some of those objects. So this pattern started to develop as this man would visit this post and more people would arrive at the post. And this man, as he would come back every year, became quite successful in his own community as Anishinaabe, because he was bringing so many things of value back to his people. Likewise, he became very well respected at the beginning of this fort that was developing in this area, because he was also enriching those that came to live amongst him. And with this, as he would go back and forth, his status would grow because his ability to help others became even greater. And as long as he continued to grow in his ability to serve others, his stature rose. Well, some years went by with this pattern, and one day as he was trading back to the post, there were more people there, and there were now more Anishinaabe and other First Nations people gathered. He noticed that a lot of people were interested in some liquid that was present. And he saw a lot of strange things happening as that liquid is being taken. What the traders had done is they had brought whiskey into the territory. In Anishinaabe, whiskey is called Asubpeeschoseewagong. It's actually literally fire water. And this person took some of that Asubpeeschoseewagong and felt something he had never felt before. He could dream like he never dreamed before. He felt an excitement that he never felt before. It charged him and gave him another motivation. So the next year, spent his time accumulating more. Again, he brought a lot back to his community as a result of the trade, came back, and this year he devoted most of his trading goods that he received to that Asubpeeschoseewagong. He didn't bring back the cloth, didn't bring back the kettles, didn't bring back the tobacco, the other goods that people were needing. And on receiving it, he fell into that state. He's using that as he's going home, and people along the way are also falling into a state. And it's becoming a challenge for the people to be able to receive this. He continues to develop this pattern. As he develops this pattern over the years, eventually he becomes less successful as a hunter. And so his status starts to decrease within his community. And because he's not able to help people, not as many people rely upon him, look to him. And likewise at the fort, when he goes back, he's not able to bring as much because he's obviously been stricken in his ability to hunt because he gets so dependent on the whiskey that's there. He's developing an addiction. This goes on for some time until this person is not able to hunt but a few pelts, and not able to bring back anything but a few pieces of mangy old cloth. And one day, as he's there at the end of the hunting season at the fort, he recognizes what has occurred to him. He's lost all his status. He's not able to help out anyone anymore. He's not respected amongst his own people. He's not respected amongst the people in the fort. And so in that state, he lies down in the snow. And he says, this is it. My life is over. I'm going to lie here till the cold takes me, till I'm gone. I don't want to live anymore. And in that state, he's lying there, and he looks up. And he looks up, and he sees one of the Anishinaabe constellations, Wingwa'age, the Wolverine. Because Anishinaabe constellations contain cases, contain stories like the one I told you at the beginning of the lecture about the deer, the moose, and the caribou. This man recognized something that he needed to do. Now, some people said it was the constellation that he saw. Other people say it was actually the spirit of the Wolverine that came to him. And the message was to take the spirit of that Wolverine and act like that Wolverine. And now, you know, reason by way of analogy. That's what we do in the common law, right? Reason by way of analogy. Follow the kind of life that you see with this one. And you know that a Wolverine is a fearsome animal, able to defend and protect him or herself, and ranges over wide territory in order to do so. And so with that, seeing that constellation, having that visit, this song then came to this man, which indicates what had been happening to him there. Now, a part of many Algonquian songs that you'll hear will have something in them called vocables. They're not words in Anishinaabemowin. They're not words in English. They're actually words that are meant to communicate to the spirit of these kinds of animals. They're another kind of language that doesn't necessarily sound in our ears in a way that, you know, as I'm talking right now. Another part of the language, though, is in here, which is Anishinaabemowin. And the words are Giwashkwebi indigo anishadash indigo, which is I was Giwashkwebi means turning around, falling down, confused. Actually, it means to do that through liquid. B is the word for liquid. So this man is falling around drunk. Giwashkwebi indigo. I was always falling around drunk. Anishadash indigo, I'm next to nothing. And so in that stage, this is where this song came to this man. Now that patterning of a song is repeated four times. And the four is very significant. It correlates with the cardinal directions, coordinates with the seasons. So there's medicines at each of the four directions. There's stages of life that's there. There's animals that are there. I mean, I just go on and on. There's just dozens of things that are coordinated with that four, and this song replicates that pattern. So we'll begin. Stay with me. I quay, I quay, I quay, I quay. Uh-huh, you quench. So that's the song. And again, you can hear I don't have the greatest voice. And maybe it felt a little bit like in listening to this that there was a discomfort like Justice McEachern encountered. But nevertheless, it's important to recognize that in this song contains principles that again would have been brought to the treaty. Right? When they were encountering in the Treaty 3 negotiations, people coming amongst them and saying, we want to be in your land, we want to travel, we want to enjoy this opportunity to be around and with you, this kind of song and other songs would have been there. Now the rest of the story is that when receiving this song and looking at this animal, this man stood up from the snow and he walked back to his community and he apologized to those that he had offended along the way and said, I'm not going to do that anymore, which is take of that liquid that I've been given. And so he started a path to recovery. And the next year when he went hunting, he wasn't as good as he had used to have been. But nevertheless, he was able to get some furs and some pelts and bring them back to the fort. And in return, he was able to bring some of the goods that he got in trade back to his people, and he felt good about himself, and his stature raised a little bit. And this went on for some time until eventually he not only came back to the stature that he had prior to his falling into this state of drunkenness, he had a stature that was even to exceed what he had prior to any point that he had been in this relationship with others. And so it's a happy story. Right? It's a story that showed he was able to take the guidance from that animal, take the guidance from that song, take the benefits that were present in dealing with other people that were coming to his territory, and find ways to reconcile and deal with them in a productive, healthy way. This song, by the way, is also the song of the Anishinaabe Academy in Minneapolis, which is the Anishinaabe Immersion School in Minneapolis, Minnesota. The song has continued to be learned, and those young kids that hear it are also expected to take the kind of message, again, take the law, calibrate their lives, and make judgments in that regard. Now you notice when I was drumming, right, this Dayweyagun, as it's called, has a sound that also calls out. So it's not just the singer, but actually is a part of the communication of the law. Dayway is actually Dayway is like a sound waving again. A gun is an instrument. It's animate in Anishinaabe mourning. Remember I talked about the world being divided between things that are living and not living? One of the things that's living in Anishinaabe mourning is Dayweyagun. It's a living thing. And so therefore people treat their drums as living things. I remember going over to the British Museum in London a few years ago and being able to go into the archives that were housed in different parts of London. We were able to bring out the drums and the other objects that were there and feast them and give them water, smudge for their food, so that they could continue to feel that they weren't forgotten, that they were remembered. So there's something about the animacy of the voice that's called there. And of course, this is meant to also sound out an echo of a heartbeat. A kick is the earth. It's meant to echo the heartbeat of Mother Earth. So when people use their drums in that fashion, there's a lot of things that are intertwined together. Those kinds of ideas, again, would have been so significant in thinking about relating to the crown through treaties. They would have brought stories, thinking, here's how we're going to treat with, create obligations with Governor Morris and Dawson and McKay, who were there as the treaty party. They would also have sung the song, maybe not this song in particular, but it was alive at the time the treaty was a part of their experience. They would have sung songs as well and danced to communicate what they were hoping to get out of the arrangements. So we now can turn with that factual background to further facts, which is to recognize that Anishinaabe people had their own laws of use and ownership that set out to create their relationships with the crown. We also know that the Hudson Bay Company had been in these territories for at least 150 years prior to the signing of Treaty 3. So it wasn't as if Brown and English people were unfamiliar to the Anishinaabe. There weren't many of them, but they nevertheless knew about trading, and they knew about reciprocity. They were familiar with contractual-like principles because they'd been involved in a contracting type of relationship that wasn't, again, just always on the English idea of contract. The Hudson's Bay Company itself, when it was transacting trade, had to find a way to also abide by Anishinaabe systems of obligation, which are more like gift systems of exchange. There, of course, is the Royal Proclamation of 1763, which sets a part of the backdrop to this, which is that the Indians are to be left unmolested and undisturbed in their territory until such time as there's a public meeting called for the purpose of entering into treaties. And then in that public meeting, it couldn't be the local officials that gathered and signed treaties with the Indians. It had to be that more distant power. Right? That's what the Royal Proclamation put into law. We also know that that was then received by 2,000 chiefs at Niagara. Anishinaabe people being amongst those chiefs at Niagara. So they already had a treaty with the Crown. And in some respects, what happened in Treaty 3 should always be calibrated by those earlier agreements. It's not like this is the first time they've ever entered into a relationship and then you just start the clock running in 1873, the year the treaty was negotiated. You add to that the participation of indigenous peoples in the wars that took place between the French and the English and the French and the Americans, and we should not forget that the Americans were claiming territories that are just south up here. In fact, many Anishinaabe people that would have been in the Lake of the Woods area had entered into treaties with another government already, the American government, and they would have been there. There's a treaty of 1855 around the Red Lake area, which is in northern Minnesota. There were treaties in Wisconsin and Minnesota. They also knew about the Robinson-Huron treaties and Robinson-Superior treaties of 1850. Right? These people just didn't live isolated as savages alone in the forest. Right? They had a commercial world that connected down to St. Paul, Minneapolis, down further down the Red River, connected out through the St. Lawrence River, connected out across to the Saskatchewan River, connected up to the forts that were coming out of the Hudson's Bay Company. And so when they came to the treaty, there would have been a knowledge of those issues. In 1868, after Confederation, there were provisions made in the British North America Act of 1867 to purchase what was called Rupert's Land, which this territory was considered on the part of the Crown as being. This land was considered to have been given by certain people in the English government to this corporation, the Hudson's Bay Company. And when Treaty 1 and 2 were signed, the Indians kept saying, "We don't like you saying that this is the company's land. They never bought this land from us as a corporation. This is our own land." And so there was a lot of animosity about the Crown claiming the Rupert's Land, the Hudson's Bay Territory. And so what happened was there was formal procedures made between Canada and Great Britain to buy out the Hudson's Bay share in those territories. But in buying out that share, it didn't mean that that land then vested immediately in the Crown because the Aboriginal peoples were still living there. You also have, in this period prior to the treaty, the Métis rebellions of 1868. We're going to talk about that in another week from now. Not next week, the week after. So the people in Ottawa were quite nervous because all of these Aboriginal peoples skipping over the Lake of the Woods area were suddenly at war with the Crown. And they had the ability to insist on their own terms in dealing with the Crown. In fact, they kept the Crown out from even being able to survey the Red River District. And so here are these Anishinaabe people between the Red River and places like Ottawa and Quebec, and they themselves are thinking about what the Métis people have done and wondering if maybe one of the ways they could assert their protection of the land is in the way like the Métis people did. And so there was some demands that Crown came to the Indians three times to ask for this Treaty 3, and they failed the first two times. The first time they came, the Ojibwe made these demands at Fort Frances, and there's a document from that time. We, the undersigned leaders of the various bands of Indians in the vicinity of Fort Frances and the Lake of the Woods, will agree to make the treaty with the Queen's commissioners on the following conditions: payments, suits, guns, farm animals, tools, food, and that all the aforesaid demands should last, if granted, forever. They talked about for as long as the grass grows, rivers flow, and the sun shines. And they have songs about that as well. And that is to say, during all the time that an Indian will be alive in this part of the country. So they have proposed this amongst other things, and the Crown said, that's too much. And so they came back again the following year in 1870, and they met with the same result. The Indians said, we don't want to enter into a treaty on the terms that you're giving. This is our land. And so then you get the Treaty 3 negotiations of 1763. An interesting image here on these treaty medals. You see the shaking hands, which harkens back to the Treaty of Niagara, as people had their hands joined together. You see the sun shining, the river flowing, the grass is a part of the hatchets buried in the bottom there. And you see an image over here. Who are the Indians negotiating with? The Crown. There's actually a crown, right? And when Governor Morris comes amongst the Anishinaabe, he says, I represent the Queen. Now, the Indians did understand that the government of Ottawa was separate from the Queen, but the Indians understood that Morris was acting as an agent of the Queen. Therefore, the negotiation was with the more distant party, not the local party, right? Consistent with the Royal Proclamation, consistent with the Treaty of Niagara, consistent with those principles that creates a check and balance and makes sure that the local people aren't too incentivized in relationship to the Indians, because with the local people being incentivized in relationship to the Indians, there's often a temptation to overreach in relationship to the Indians, which would molest and disturb them, which would be contrary to the terms of the Royal Proclamation. So this is the background to that treaty understanding. And before I read you quotes from this Treaty 3 negotiation, on the ground on where we stand, we hear the rustling of gold under our feet, is some of the things that the chief said. Or, this is our property, this is our land, is something they repeatedly affirmed. And so they entered into this treaty, they received these medals, they sung, they prayed, they used the pipe, they had many sources of recording this agreement. Ontario was barely in this area at the time. You'll know that they're down by the Robinson Hurons, Robinson Superior area, but there's a dispute about this land, and these demands are reiterated in the treaty negotiations. Governor Morris was a founder of Confederation. He was John A. Macdonald's friend. He knew about the centralizing tendencies of the federal government. He knew about the powers of disallowance, preventing the provinces from being involved in certain affairs. He knew about what John A. Macdonald was trying to do and create a more unitary country as opposed to a federal kind of country. And Governor Morris, bringing all this experience, came to the negotiating table, and Ontario had no participation in either of the preliminary negotiations or the negotiations of 1873. Yes, question.
First line, second line?
Yes.
1871, 1972 or
1872? That's 1872. That's right.
Okay.
And here's the treaty territory that we're talking about. And you can see the Grassy Narrows First Nations is to the west of that territory, a huge swath of land. And you can see where other First Nations are still located today in those territories. And so what happens is the Grassy Narrows people bring an action because of the clear cutting that's taking place in their territory. And they're contesting whether or not Ontario has the power to take up lands under the treaty in accordance with the taking up clause. We've seen those kind of clauses before. They say it should be Canada that has the right to take up the lands, because that's the party that we negotiated with. So the first issue here is, does Ontario have the authority under Treaty 3 to take up lands in the Keewatin district? Keewatin is an Anishinaabe word. Giwe is to go home. It's the go home direction. It's actually north. Giwatin is north. So in these northern lands, does Ontario have the authority to take up these lands? And does the doctrine of interjurisdictional immunity preclude Ontario from justifying an infringement of Treaty 3 rights? Now the court is going to find that Ontario does have the authority to take up these lands. And the court's also going to find that because of the Chilcotin case, which had been decided just a few weeks before the Grassy Narrows case came out, that Ontario was not precluded from justifying infringement of Aboriginal lands. There's no protection that Indians receive federally speaking through federalism doctrines of interjurisdictional immunity to prevent Ontario from infringing those lands. So that's the facts. Those are the issues, and you know the answers to those issues, right? Ontario has the authority to take up tracts. The doctrine of interjurisdictional immunity does not prevent Ontario from infringing Aboriginal or treaty rights that would be in this area. Now, here's the clause. They, the said Indians, shall have the right to pursue their avocations of hunting and fishing throughout the said tracts surrendered, as herein described. And saving and accepting such tracts as may from time to time be required or taken up for settlement, mining, lumbering, or other purposes by her said government of the Dominion of Canada, or by any of the subjects that are duly authorized thereof by the said government. So the text of the treaty says that land can only be taken up by the Dominion government. Now we know the text is not always binding in treaties, right? They're just evidence of the oral agreement. But we also know when you interpret treaties, you give them a large, liberal, and generous interpretation, resolving any ambiguities in favor of the Indians, looking at the treaty as the Indians would naturally understand them. So here we've got a text that says the federal government is the one that has the power to take up. So you might understand why the Anishinaabe at one level think that what Ontario is doing is contrary to treaty just by the text alone. Never mind the Royal Proclamation, Treaty of Niagara, other promises that they've received through the years about it being the more distant government, which is the one that they will always have that relationship with. So it goes through the lower courts. The Ontario Supreme Court of Justice found in favor of the First Nation, which is the government of Canada could not take up those lands. Sorry, the government of Ontario could not take up these lands because that was reserved to the government of Canada. The trial lasted 75 days. It was a huge volume of materials, 9,440 transcript pages, 3,710 pages of documents. There's a lot of evidence put in about the Indian understanding. And again, this evidence was weighed and found in favor of the First Nation. The decision itself is 1,663 paragraphs long. It's a tome to be able to look through. Then it goes to the Ontario Court of Appeal, And they rule against the First Nation. And they set aside the trial decision. That is, they overturn the Superior Court of Justice. They make a finding that, yes, Ontario can take up lands for lumber, mining, settlement, other purposes. And so we now are going to look at how the Supreme Court treated what was appealed from the Ontario Court of Appeal. And the court, in coming to its conclusion, had three pillars of decision. One of those pillars of decision is Canada's constitutional provisions, the way that they are read broadly, prevent the First Nation from saying that only the Crown and Right of Canada is the one that can take up the lands. They look at the actual Treaty 3 clause itself, and they come to a conclusion that when you read that clause in light of other agreements that were signed at the time, or just after, the boundary dispute between Ontario and Canada, that that also lends credence to the fact that Ontario should be able to take up those lands. And then finally, further to that point, there's legislation dealing with the lands after the boundary settlement. So we're going to take each of these points in turn and go through the opinion. So the first question is the question about the Constitution's provisions concerning treaties and the taking up clause here. Now, where I am in the opinion as we begin this discussion is on paragraph 31, and we'll be going to paragraph 37. So in those short paragraphs, that's where the court is going to deal with these constitutional provisions. So here's what the court says in paragraph 30. Although Treaty 3 was negotiated by the federal government, it is an agreement between the Ojibwe and the Crown. The level of government that exercises or performs the rights and obligations under the treaty is determined by the provisions of the Constitution. And so we know, right, that the Crown in Canada is divided. You have a federal crown and a provincial crown. And whoever has the constitutional authority for administering different arms of the Crown's duties, that's the party that is the one that the agreement is with. Now, this is important to just stop here for a moment and say, what is happening here? We see federalism taking precedence over treaty principles. It's like a rock, game of rock, paper, and scissors. And it's federalism always wins over the treaty, at least in this framing of the provisions. Court further says in paragraph 31 that once the Keewatin lands came within Ontario's borders in 1912, section 109 of the Constitution Act, 1867, became applicable. This is St. Catharines Milling and Lumber Company case and the Crown 2. This is the sequel. And sequels are never as good. This is the same territory that we were dealing with in 1888 as we went to the Privy Council, the same people and the same conclusion. Section 109, which gives rights in land in a province to the province, saving and accepting any trusts that might be on the land, or any interest other than the province in the same lands. The court also said, in addition, section 92.5 of the Constitution Act gives the province exclusive power over the management and sale of public lands belonging to the province and of the timber and the wood thereon. So it's not just section 109, but there's, you know, the section 92 chronicle gives the province power over land and sale of wood from land. And then section 92A, which is the natural resource provision, also gives the province exclusive power to make laws in relationship to non-renewable natural resources, forestry resources, and electrical energy. So this is to just reiterate what I said earlier, that treaties have to conform themselves to federalism. Federalism cannot override or overwrite the treaty structure, treaties cannot overwrite the federal structure. Even though treaties come from the first peoples of the land, there's something more hardwired about federalism. It's the main program that's operating in this system. And Indian programs sometimes can be incorporated with the federalism program, sometimes they're a virus, or sometimes they just get lost as bits of information that don't really get folded into the understanding of federalism. Now here's what the Ontario Court of Appeals said as they were making the same point. The taking up clause has to be interpreted in light of the constitutional evolution. From the time of the Royal Proclamation to the creation of Canada in 1840, to the creation of the Dominion in 1867, and finally to the extension of Ontario's border in 1912. Throughout that process of constitutional evolution, the Crown and the relationship between Crown and Canada's Aboriginal peoples remains a constant, central, and defining people. Sorry, feature. What has evolved is the allocation of legislative and administrative powers, responsibilities, to different levels of government. So, the treaty remains constant, but there's this evolution of the federal state that, as you know from first year constitutional law, sees the province growing at the expense of the federal government through most of the sweep of our history. In formal terms, what changes with the constitutional evolution is the level of government on whose advice the Crown acts. The principle of constitutional evolution has an important bearing upon treaties with First Nations. Treaties are solemn, they last indefinitely, they're not frozen in time. Treaties must be capable of adapting to the natural evolution of the Constitution, which evolves as a living tree. I like the fact that they're departing from originalism here. I think we've seen the problems with originalism in the way that the Vanderpeek case was framed. But why isn't it that federalism is adapting itself to the treaties? Why doesn't the adaption run in the other direction? Is kind of one of the questions I have here. Yes.
Why wasn't the discussion that the First Nations people weren't a player in making up the Constitution?
Yeah, First Nations didn't participate in the Constitution. Why then does the federal fact get to override their non-participation in that? Is an appropriate question. So it's a constitutional evolution that, you know, by and large sees Indians fall between the cracks of federalism. Mostly about the provincial and the federal government. You saw that in St. Catharines Milling and Lumber Company case. Right? Indians' interests weren't really clearly articulated there, and so it is for most of our history that Indians have fallen between the cracks of the federalism. We've had an evolution that becomes the thing that is the standard against by which we measure treaty rights, and yet in coming to that conclusion, Indians haven't participated.
Just a question on terminology. If you look at this, the land is being decided by the province.
Yes.
And yet that same land is called Crown land. Uh-huh. And if you look at reserves, that's called Crown land.
Yes.
And it's governed by the federal government.
That's right. And so what the court is saying here is that there's two different types of Crown land. There's Crown land that is like reserved land under Section 9124 that Indians occupy, that's been reserved for them. But then there's also Crown land in right of the province, that the province has the right to be able to take up, use, occupy in the session. This does not accord with the Indians' understanding of what they were doing when they entered into the treaty. In fact, here's what the trial judge said. Here's the understanding of the Indians at the time of treaty, after treaty. I find the Ojibwe knew and agreed they were giving up exclusive use of their lands and would be sharing the resources with your Canadians after the treaty was signed. So there was a sharing that was going to take place. They expected your Canadian and Ojibwe uses to be compatible. Away from the Dawson and CPR roots, I find the Ojibwe did not accept that they would be required to curtail or change their traditional subsistence act, harvesting and trading activity. They did not understand that there would be significant limitations on their harvesting rights. I do not infer that they understood that it would be increasing and cumulative negative impacts on the way of life on which would result in extinguishment by slices. Right? They didn't think that the taking of paws would extinguish their rights by, you know, now mines taken up, can't use it there. Now forestry operation occurs, can't use it there. The Ojibwe understood they were agreeing to allow some European occupancy, and they would be sharing the use of the lands with and benefiting from the use of the lands by the European Canadians. Right? Lingua Age, the song I've sung to you. The treaty with the deer, the moose, and the caribou. They expected, for example, to share in the benefits of anticipated timber operations, including receiving wages for labor. Had they perceived that a treaty would bring serious detriments to or seriously interfere with their way of life, they would have refused to sign. I find, the court says, here at trial, that McKay did not translate the treaty, word by word, into Ojibwe, because he did not refer specifically to limiting of harvesting rights by regulation by Canada. And he therefore did not refer to limitation of harvesting rights by taking up by Canada either. There was no taking up clause that was communicated to the Ojibwe. And then, so that's understanding about the land. Here's, and that's the finding of fact by the court at trial. It wasn't overturned as a finding of fact, just ignored, right, in the Supreme Court. Here's their understanding of the treaty partner. I find the Ojibwe understood that the only government with which they were dealing with and which they would deal after the treaty was signed was the Queen's government of Ottawa, the only government that Morse mentioned. I have found the Ojibwe did not question the commissioners or seek clarification about the source of their authority on October 3rd, because they already understood from Morse's explanation given on October 2nd that they were there on behalf of the Council at Ottawa that governed the Great Dominion, and they were content with that. They, that is, the Ojibwe, understood from what Morse told them that the government with which they were dealing and would be dealing was a unitary government. They did not understand, because they were not advised, that any other government could potentially affect their treaty rights. They did not agree to have their harvesting rights adversely affected by any other government. I find the Ojibwe were looking to form an alliance with the Queen's government at Ottawa, and were looking to implement it and enforce it by treaty. Now, what the court is going to say at the Supreme Court of Canada is all this doesn't matter about their understanding of the treaty partner, because federalism evolved, Crown evolves, Section 109, Section 92, 5, 92A are what we look to in determining what the obligations of a government are in relationship to the treaty. So what you get here is an application of a treaty where there are no canons of construction to be found. You read through Grassy Narrows, all that stuff we've been talking about, three classes. If we were to take seriously who they thought about their treaty partner was, if we were to take seriously they weren't actually extinguishing their rights to continue to use the land, they were going to share the land with others. They realized it wasn't going to be an exclusive use anymore, but in sharing they continue to benefit, which presumes they'd also continue to make decisions in relationship to this land. But this is not a treaty that is given a large, liberal, and generous construction, as the Indians would naturally understand it, resolving ambiguities in favor of the Indians. So there's no Aboriginal perspective on the meaning of the rights at stake. The court views the Crown as the Crown views the Crown, right? As a divided body with a federal and a provincial arm. The court does not view the Crown as the First Nations view the Crown. And court finds the treaty does not modify federalism. And even within federalism, Section 92 is stronger than Section 91. This is paragraph 37 of the opinion. Section 91.24 does not give Canada the authority take up provincial land for exclusively provincial purposes. Thus, Section 91.24 does not require Ontario to obtain federal approval before it can take up the land under Treaty 3. What you have in 2014 is an eroding of a 250-year-old constitutional tradition that started with the Royal Proclamation, came from the Treaty of Niagara, was negotiated across the country, that said the more distant power is the one that should be engaged with the Indians, not the local power. This is an erosion, some might even say the death of the Royal Proclamation of 1763, or the death of the constitutional tradition that places the checks and balances in Indians' favor against the province. So thus, I just read this point there from that paragraph 37. Question.
Doesn't there have to be some devolution of power, though? Because you could say, I can see how the Royal Proclamation is written, was signed by like the Queen in Great Britain, and that power devolved to the federal government in Canada, and now the federal government has devolved power to Ontario once the province of Ontario is created.
So it's a good question. Doesn't there have to be some devolution of power from Ottawa to Canada, from Ottawa, from the Imperial Parliament to Ottawa, Ottawa to the province, or from the Imperial Province directly to the province? And on the one hand, you could say, yes, that's an efficiency that we enjoy in Canada by having local government be more responsive to dealing with lands through what's being talked about here. We enjoy the kind of quality of life that we do. There's an administrative convenience to this. But in terms of does it have to? No. Because there's alternative ways of constructing how the federal and provincial power would have interacted. Here, the Indians were arguing for a two-step process. Yes, Ontario has the right to take up the land, but the federal government has to be there as their fiduciary, that is the Indians' fiduciary, to make sure that when that land is taken up, Indians aren't molested and disturbed. Court rejects that point and says, no, the land is vested in the province by virtue of Section 109. Treaty can't change that vesting. Therefore, there's no need to seek a federal layer here in allowing that kind of devolution.
I was wondering, looking at this case in light of Chilcotin, is this almost kind of saying that if you're a First Nations group, you shouldn't really bother with treaties, you should really focus on the title? Because Chilcotin seems to say title overrules federalism concerns, but then here it's like treaty gets overruled by federalism. Yeah. So is that kind of
so it's another kind of the rock, paper, scissors, right?
Yeah.
Title gets to overrun federalism, but then federalism gets to overrun treaties. So if the Chilcotin people take their title and negotiate a treaty, it's not a good thing. Why would they come down the list like that?
Is there, I'm sort of trying to look at this in the light, because I know in Chilcotin they were very clear in saying that we don't want to hear IJI arguments anymore. And it seems like they're just so scared that if they allowed the treaty sort of to override federalism in this case, that it would create the vacuums that for some reason the Crown is terrified of.
Yeah.
And that, you know, like this is sort of covering for that possibility of happening.
Yeah.
Because if in whatever situation the province can't act in the, well, I don't know what I'm trying to say. Like if the federal government doesn't step in, then there is a vacuum.
Yeah.
And this is just a safeguard for that ever happening.
Yeah, this is a judgment on the part of the court that wants to ensure that federalism is protected, that provinces' authority is not eroded. Because the stakes are high, right? If Ontario can't make decisions about clear-cutting that land that's next to the Grassy Narrow First Nation, that's money out of their coffers, right? So there's not the same amount of money then to pay for education or build roads or, you know, do other things that are part of what the province is expected by the use of those lands in their region.
I'm just trying to make sure I understand the implications. So, because to me, like, even if the court found that Ontario didn't have the right to take up the lands, that the federal government could still take up these lands and still have the same test of, like, the amicus curiae where they don't have to justify it unless
yes.
the right's gone. So, like, does this really change?
So that's a good point. So say we had that two-step process where province can take up lands, but it has, Canada has to take up lands, but it's done so in conjunction with the province. you still might have a federal government that's all for the taking up of those lands. So how does the old 250-year-old story protect Indians and family? Maybe it's a good thing that 250-year-old story is dying, because it's not been all that beneficial to the Indians, as you've seen the erosion of their rights. So yeah, it might not even be protection in the way that the First Nation are asking for here, except to the extent, if you accepted their interpretation, which is they didn't surrender the land. They didn't actually agree to a taking up clause. And they did want their relationship to be a more national, nation-to-nation relationship, not a nation, First Nation-to-province relationship.
if the sort of government rights can be negotiated with the Crown, and the Crown is also Ontario, but doesn't like the obligations they have in the treaty, then also sort of in regards to those lands, also flow through the federal government to Ontario, if Ontario's going to...
So the court's going to come to the conclusion, as we move through the case further, that the obligations that the federal government has to have a valid legislative objective for the Grand Fringe Indian issues, they have to have the honor of the Crown if they're going to infringe Indian issues, those obligations that the federal Crown has are also obligations that the provincial Crown has. And so the court is switching the protection that the Indians can rely upon. It used to be they could rely upon the protections, which weren't all that great, of the federal government stepping to their aid, being in a fiduciary capacity because of their more distant likelihood of not being involved in local powers. They're substituting that for the Sparrow test of infringement and justification. That's where this decision ends up going. But it's now a question about infringement and justification, whether or not, but a question about whether or not the thing that you're seeing can be done, the taking up of lands, is actually even possible under the treaty. But the court says in paragraph 2, the Ojibwe yielded ownership of their territory. Second sentence. The Ojibwe yielded ownership of their territory, except certain lands reserved to them. The trial judge said, no, they didn't. They did not yield those lands. But the way this court constructs what the Indians have, by focusing on federalism, loses sight of the most important thing that the Indians were trying to bring in this decision, which was they still have a right to have a relationship with their land, because they're worried, as that man in the Gwingo Abe story would have been worried, as the caribou, moose, and deer were worried about how they were being treated when they're living amongst the Anishinaabe. So let's keep going. That's just the first part. Right.
I'm just gonna say that it seems to me the concern about legislative vacuum fits awkwardly even with Tim Chokotin, because the court on the one hand says once you have land under Aboriginal title, neither the federal parliament nor the provincial legislature can legislate without the consent of the Aboriginal community holding it. So it doesn't seem worried about legislative vacuum there. It sounds like because the Aboriginal community will be able to manage the land and has that power,
yeah,
their management will fill the vacuum.
Yeah.
So it's weird when the court turns around and says if provincial laws of general applicability don't apply to Aboriginal title lands, we could have this patchwork for legislative vacuum.
So yeah,
it kind of undercuts their focus on Aboriginal management of the land.
That's
and
right.
Legislation applicable to
that. And this court does the same thing, right? Which is undercut Aboriginal management of land by ignoring the fact that they have a relationship with it through their laws that they thought was protected by the treaty. And self-governance goes missing here. Right? The Aboriginal perspective on the meaning of the right at stake, which was a management and use perspective that flows from their law, is empty in these pages. Yes?
I was just wondering if maybe the reason that, because it seems very like contradictory, I wonder if it's just because there's a lot of treaties out there, title hadn't really been established, and the court can kind of slowly established title rather than having a bunch of trees, and suddenly they're a lot more powerful.
That's right, because this taking up clause is found in most all the number of treaties, right? So you question the Treaty 3 taking up clause, suddenly you're throwing up on not just Ontario lands being taken up, but Manitoba, Saskatchewan, Alberta, Northwest Territories. You remember the Paulette case we read with Treaty 11? That was unbelievable that people could have walked away from that treaty thinking that Indians had surrendered their rights to land. If the court would have opened that kettle of fish here and said the Indians have some management, governance rights over their lands, even after treaty, right, then suddenly the whole national economy is needing attention.
So why didn't they go there? I mean, if
the stakes are too high.
But it would have made things right.
It would have made things right. What wins here, right or money?
Money
wins here.
It's disgusting. It really is.
It makes you mad. So, interpretation of Treaty 3. The court does not read the clause literally. Paragraph 38 of the opinion, which says, remember, this is the Dominion of Canada that has the right to go to take up the land. The court says that the Crown includes all government power, and the court reads the treaty within the context of the boundary dispute. So I found this very interesting. Basically, what's happening here is the court says, we can understand what the treaty means by looking at the dispute that Ontario had with Canada about its boundaries in 1894 and 1912. And I think, what? How do we know what the treaty says by looking at some negotiations that happened between Canada and Ontario? Right? Where's the Indians' understanding of it? It's not even actually looking at the treaty, it's looking at the interpretation that the Ontario and provincial government have of the treaty in the boundary dispute afterwards. The court is not deferential to the finding of facts by the trial judge about this two-step process. They don't say anything about who they thought the Crown was, the Ojibwe thought the Crown was, or what they thought they were surrendering, but they do overturn the two-step process. What does that do with the facts that haven't been overturned that otherwise exist here? Can the Treaty 3 people one day come forward and say, hey, that trial judge said back there that we didn't surrender our land. The Supreme Court didn't say anything about that here. They just said the two-step process was not something that was contemplated. Maybe that's alive for another day. I don't know. It could be res judicata. Maybe you cannot raise that anymore because you might infer that the Supreme Court here was also making comment about the Ojibwe understanding. And then the court says, on the bottom of page, paragraph 40, there's no Ojibwe taking, no objection. Sorry. Let me read it. I would note that Ontario has exercised the power to take up lands for a period of over 100 years with any objection by the Ojibwe. What? Grassy Narrows? Mercury poisoning? Blockades? St. Catharines Milling and Lumber Company? Seems like there's been 100 years of conflict over how Ontario is using that land. I don't get that sentence. It seems to be actually flat out contradicted by the facts on the ground. And if you're interested, there's a newspaper clipping, actually a CBC, I think, website report on the poisoning of these people that's still ongoing. The Japanese scientists are coming over and working with Ojibwe people to figure out how they can help them through that poisoning. And then there's a movie that you can watch here. I gotta go. But the last point is this legislation dealing with the Treaty 3 lands. I think we've covered the point. The ambiguities in the legislation and treaty are resolved in the province's favor. Right, you look at what the 1894 agreement said, the Privy Council case said, the 1912 legislation said, and you just read it as the province and Ontario would understand it, not as the Indians would understand it. So there is, though, this now substitution. Ontario stands in the shoes of the federal government for making sure that the honor of the Crown is followed and there's a fiduciary duty exercised when lands are taken up. The Mikisew Cree case applies. Good faith is always required. Accommodation is sometimes required. So the Indians aren't without remedy here in regard to these clear cuts that are taking place around them. whether or not they'll be able to succeed in getting a different management regime without their own governance being a part of this remains to be seen. And then, of course, interjurisdictional immunity does not apply here. Again, thank you for your participation today. The next class will come and we'll deal with this point. What are the Crown obligations? How should they be properly construed? And we'll see you next Monday.